going to call the meeting to order. We're going to observe a moment of silent reflection, as we have done in the past and will continue to do. Gives you your time to reflect on your thoughts and your things going on in your mind for the day. So, thank you. Thank you. Let's all stand for the pledge, and I'm going to ask Councilman Harry Collins if he will return the pledge for us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Are there any adjustments to the agenda?
Mr. Mayor, we'd like to request one minor adjustment. That is, under consent agenda item B, we reference the scheduling of a public hearing, and the date noted is March the 25th. That date should be corrected to March the 28th.
Okay. Anything else?
No, sir.
Thank you. Do we have any public hearings tonight? I don't see any listed. Apparently no. Very good. Next on the agenda is the consent agenda. We have four things. Minutes of the 28th of February. Scheduled public hearing to change the date to the 28th. Public hearing on the April 25th for rezoning request. And a public hearing on April the 25th, conditional use permit.
I make a motion we approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion, additions?
This is the reason why we did a consent agenda. It makes a lot of sense now, doesn't it?
It certainly does. Most of the time.
That's right.
Madam Clerk, will you poll council, please?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That would be 5-0 with Mr. Bishop absent. Thank you. Citizens' comments. This is a section that we open each week at each of our meetings to allow our citizens to come forward and state what's on your mind, ask questions, make comments, anything that you would like to bring before council to make us aware of. So is there anyone here that wishes to address council? Hearing none, I will close the citizens' comment portion. Next is the introductions and presentations. Melissa Powell, our public information officer, is going to handle this for us.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
March is Youth Art Month, and that is a celebration of the visual arts in a way to encourage support of quality school art programs. So in honor of this month, we have several individuals here tonight we'd like to recognize. We have 7 Christiansburg High School students who received Scholastic Art Awards, and Scholastic Art Award is the nation's longest running and most prestigious recognition program for creative teens in grades 7 through 12. And we also have here members of the Christiansburg High School AP Studio Art class, and they're helping to put together a display of artwork for the Montgomery Museum. And that display is scheduled to go up in early April. So I have a short presentation, and I forgot the clicker. So let me grab that. Mm-hmm. It'll work for me tonight. I know that the most, if not all, of the students that are featured in this PowerPoint are here tonight. So no pressure. But if you want to speak to your piece of artwork as we go through it and kind of explain your inspiration for it or give us a little more details, feel free to speak up. And then afterward, we have some certificates we're going to pass out. The mayor's going to help me do that. So we have Courtney Caldwell's piece here. She has a Scholastic Honorable Mention.
Can we at least have them, if they don't want to speak, at least stand up
stand,
so we can recognize
yes.
them? I'm not trying to put you out of the
time. Now the truth, you got anything you want to say?
That's right.
That's pretty good. Thank you.
Clay Curry, right here.
Feel free to chime in, girls. All on camera, matter of public record.
Grace. Brittany. We don't have Brittany with us.
What was the format of that last one? It was quality or quilling technique?
Grace? Where was Grace at?
We're going to get something out of you.
What was your motivation out of the space today? Soccer? Wasn't soccer, was it?
Yeah. Okay, so quilling is like you take thin sheets of paper and you take glue and you kind of like just move it around the paper and try to get it to stay. It took me like a month.
So is this a 3D? Is this a 3D piece then?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Very interesting.
Eddie has several pieces coming up, so we'll make you stand the whole time. But
Eddie, how long have you been involved in art, doing projects like this nature?
I've started, this has been my first art class in years, so I've only really started it this past year, so.
With all these particular mediums that you have, any particular one in general that you like the most, you like working with the most?
I feel like I've done the most with like paper mache and whatnot. That's what the dragon.
That was a dragon, the first one we saw.
Uh-huh. So. This one here was pretty fun with you just like latex and cotton for the demon sort of guy, and so that was pretty interesting. But, so, and there's also a fan in the hole that he sits in, and there's some ribbons, so it kind of looks like there's fire
and flame.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, yeah, same motorized fans, right?
So you're on block, right?
You what?
You did all this the first term?
Yeah.
That's a Valley Car Council. Unstable stability. That's that's us up here.
That's right.
There you go.
Well, that's good. Sand.
Takes a
little
bit to do.
Well, that's amazing for sand, isn't it?
Very good. That's right.
It's the last of the presentation, but we have some certificate stand up, so maybe if you help me do that and I'll get my camera. If everybody,
Scoop, get your camera.
Yeah, if anyone wants to take photos, feel free. We'll call these out. I'm going to grab my camera because I forgot that too.
And my understanding, Mayor, is that this will be an exhibit. I see Sue's here, and this will be an exhibit at the Montgomery Museum as well.
We have an exhibit from the students from Christiansburg High. I don't know what's coming.
I understand. Yeah. Very good.
Oh, and that's in early April, right?
Right. So am I doing great. This? Are you here with
yeah.
me?
Yeah. No, I'm here. Well, I'm here. I'm going to take photos.
All right. Thank you. Courtney Caldwell. Claire Curry. Stay put this. We're going to get a deep shot. Nicole. Daniel Fleming. Sydney Honaker. Grace Martin. Brittany Osborne. She was at AOL.
Yeah. We'll keep it for her.
All right. Eddie Sheffield. Picture here in just a second. Caitlin Tanaka.
You guys want to get together for a photo?
Yeah. Can I get kind of there?
Yeah.
All right, for this photo, was,
we need to move out.
You get you four shift to right here.
Am I included in that photo?
Yeah, you'll be included. And make sure everybody can see.
Yes.
You have to go down. We're going to switch places.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of getting ready.
Get between each other.
All right. Look at me. 1, 2, 3.
Scoot.
How about some more?
Just take the lens cap off.
Okay. Still taking without me?
No, I'm good.
Everybody look this way. Still got cameras flashing.
And I believe that you guys have something to present to council, and you'd like to do that now, and I'll actually take that quick opportunity to read what we have on the
thank you. Thanks again. Very talented.
As they're organizing here, really quickly on the certificates, we're hereby recognizing them for their creative contributions and for sharing their incredible talent.
Thank you all very much.
This is awesome.
That is.
You said this is supposed to be
a
special
thing.
We're actually not done yet. We have one more item. In addition to our Christiansburg High School students, we also have Christiansburg Elementary School students here who also have a gift for you. And these are our art superstars in the making. So I'll invite all of you guys up, and perhaps we can get a photo with council. And I know the mayor has something to give back to you, and we also have something in the mail on the way to your classroom.
Awesome.
So come on up. Mr. Mayor has something to present as well.
Thank you for the gifts. Thank you, council. So what I would like to do is present each of you all with one of our official logo pins that we all wear at town council meetings when we have our suit coats on. So, thank you. I was going to tell you, I'd sweep that up. I'll sweep it up. Thank you very much.
That's
quite nice.
It's got a very great photo. We appreciate you coming, and we can great elementary students to also have something that you'll get in your classroom, so be on the lookout for that, and I know that council really appreciates these kids.
Absolutely.
Thank
you very much.
You guys are awesome. We appreciate it very much.
Now, we have a couple of school faculty here. Kelly Drake, principal. He's the principal of the middle school.
I'm at the elementary.
Brenda.
Kelly Rourke.
Sorry. I had it right first time. Kelly. Anybody else on the staff that works with these kids?
Miss Cheryl Buttman, our art teacher.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Very nice. Thank you.
We have School board members, one school board member over there, Harry. Good to see you.
Hello, how are you?
And we have the art coordinator for the county, is that something along that line? Very good. Well, thank you very much for coming out, we appreciate it.
Nice to have a crowd like this, we usually sit here by ourselves, you know?
This is a poker player to politicians' favorite time, it's a full house. Next on our agenda, we have Angie Covey, New River Community College, regarding access to community college education, ACCE. Angie, thank you so much for taking your time tonight.
Thank you. This is a perfect segue, having all these young people in the audience today, so I appreciate this. Well, I thank you very much for the opportunity to be here, and I want to talk to you about a program called ACE, Access to Community College Education. You may have heard a little bit on the news, we've been interviewed a couple times by Channel 7 and Channel 10, and there's been a lot of things in the local newspapers about the program. ACE, Access to Community College Education, and what this program means. We started this 2 years ago in Giles County. We've also implemented the program in the city of Bradford and also Floyd. And what the program means is that we were able to walk into Giles High School and Narrows High School that first year, 2 years ago. And we were able to say, every kid at this high school can go to New River Community College at no cost. So what happens, and what we mean by that, this is a public-private partnership. So the locality puts up a portion of the funding, and then we fundraise for the other portion. So when we were able to do this in Giles County, there's a bigger message here than just having that free tuition, so to speak. It's telling all of these children that they have access to community college, that we're not differentiating based on income or based on first-generation college, whatever it may be. We have one concise message that we shared in those high schools at Giles and Narrows, and it was every kid can come to New River. Now, there are a few requirements. 2.5 GPA is a requirement because we want these kids to understand that GPA does matter in high school. We're trying to create a culture there where they're going to be a little bit more accountable to their GPA. They have to do community service. They do 80 hours of community service the summer prior to beginning the program, their fall semester of college. The reason for that is we're talking to young people about life's about contribution. Life's about giving back to the community that gives to you. So in Giles County, our message was, Giles County stepped up and they made sure that every student in their community would have access to college. And in turn, you're going to give back to Giles County. And some of the things that they did in Giles, they were painting the schools, they were mulching. You know, Giles County owns their own golf course, so they were cutting grass. Some young people learned how to lay tile. Some young people learned how to dig ditches for public works. You know, it's just a variety of different jobs that they had. But the next piece that they have to do is they have to do the financial aid application. And we, as a college, will help these young people through that process of completing the financial aid application. Here's the beauty of the piece. So many of these young people, once we pull them through that financial aid application, are going to come to New River at no cost anyway. But they don't know that, and they don't understand that, and they just see and hear these things about college is out of reach. College is so expensive, and it is expensive, but it's not out of reach. And when we share that message that it's across the board, you will go to college, just do this form. They do the form, they go to New River at no cost. We had one student, so we use the financial aid dollars first, and then the ACE dollars will fill the gap. So based on what financial aid doesn't cover, we fill that gap. Student does their 80 hours of community service. We had one student, their price tag, so to speak, for the ACE program, $4. That's all that they needed to close the gap. And they still did the 80 hours of community service. because they realized that this was a pretty cool thing to do with all of their peers, is to roll their sleeves up and do some work in Giles County. So the program has been extremely successful. We are finishing our second year in Giles. Radford City, we presented to council, and of course they approved the program, and we had one donor in the city of Radford provide 100% of the matching funding so that Radford could do the program, so we were pretty excited about that. And then in Floyd County, Floyd is part of the tobacco footprint, so for that reason we were able to write a tobacco commission grant to provide the funding to make Floyd happen. Some numbers on how the program kind of fell in Giles County for the first semester. We had about 60 kids apply for the program, and these were kids that I feel very confident that there were a lot of kids in that, or parents in that room, who felt like college was absolutely out of reach. It wasn't even an option. We took them through the process. They're at New River at no cost to the program. So of the 60 kids that applied that first year in Giles, about a third of those kids got full financial aid. So there was no cost to the program. And as I said, I'm very confident that a lot of those kids would not have continued their education had we not been making this promise to all of these young people. The middle third of those kids got some financial aid, but not enough. So what the ACE program does is it closes that gap. And these are the kids, they come from families that work very hard. They make just enough that they're only getting a little bit of financial aid. So that's a very important population for us to serve. The top third percent of this program got absolutely no financial aid. Again, a very important population because they are working very hard and they get nothing, they get no support, no financial aid for college, and then that's when college does feel like it's out of reach. So of those third, we paid all of the tuition for those folks. So for that first semester, the total cost to Giles County was around $42,000. So it's not as expensive as you would think it would be because of the financial aid piece. When we talk about the program, especially if I'm talking to Board of Supervisors or councils or such, I talk about economic development. This is about economic development of your region. When companies look at the area, you know, we've all dealt with prospects that are coming in and they're looking at shell buildings and they want to know about your quality of life and they have all these great questions. But the number one question that they ask is, do you have a trained workforce? So if Montgomery County can say, yes, we have a trained workforce, and let me tell you why. We have this program called ACE, and we make sure that every high school graduate has access to community college, to a two-year occupational technical program. Now also, they have access, because our goal is for all of these young people to graduate with a two-year degree, ready to transfer to a four-year university and move on, or they're ready to graduate in 2 years and join the workforce. And a lot of the studies that you'll see talk about, there's a ratio, it's 1-7. So for every post or every advanced degree, as in a master's and a PhD degree, for every one, you need two people with a bachelor's degree to support that person. You need seven people with a one-year or two-year certificate, occupational, technical type of degree to support that. So that's how that economic structure works. So for every PhD or every master's, two bachelor's, and seven occupational technical. And that's where New River steps up for those seven, because we're putting those nurses out there, the automotive program, the welding program, the instrumentation program, you know, all those programs that we need a very skilled workforce. Montgomery County has put $100,000 in their budget for this year. So with that $100,000 that we've put in, we've estimated that the cost in Montgomery County for year one would be about $300,000. So we're going to be doing some fundraising to try to support the program. We have the local law enforcement that have been phenomenal in helping us seed this program with something called Books and Badges, which I'm sure you've heard about that. We've got Chief Sisson here, who has been one of the players behind getting the Books and Badges started. What the books and badges was, how that sort of came to be, is I was having a meeting with Chief Wilson, Blacksburg. Of course, he's bringing in Sheriff Parton and Chief Sisson. And he said, how's Giles County doing that program over there and Montgomery County is not? And I explained the program and how it worked. And he said, could we start something very small called Books and Badges? And maybe it'll catch on, and then Books and Badges could grow into the full ACE program. So that's sort of a summary of how it works. Students, another key part that I think is so important outside of the community service component. The first year in Giles County, that community service that summer was the equivalent to 1.5 full-time employees for the county. Students have to buy their own textbooks. We want them to have a little skin in the game. The program is just like an employer is paying your tuition. If you fail a class, you pay that tuition back to the program for the next student. And we've held their feet to the fire on that. And as you all know, students talk to each other and they share, and they're like, oh, those ladies in that foundation office are serious about us. If we fail a class, they come looking for us. So we make sure that they pay that tuition back. We also have a component at our college now, and it's part of our student success initiative. And so we will have a person called a connection specialist that will be assigned to all of the ACE students from a locality. And we use technology to help us make this program work. And the technology is integrated amongst all the faculty, all the connection specialists. So Johnny fails a test in math, and then he doesn't show up for the next three classes. So Johnny's faculty can raise a flag. That flag goes to the connection specialist. She looks up all of Johnny's information on one screen, and she can see, well, what's going on in English? What's going on in your psych class? What's going on in your history class? And see if there's a pattern. And what we find with a lot of these students, because at the community college, a larger number of your students are first-generation college students. And when we're talking about first-generation college, which is really the audience that we're wanting to target, these first-generation, no one in the home speaks the language of college. It's just, it's very different. So when this young person comes to New River, and they don't feel very confident about coming to college anyway, because no one in their family has, and they fail that first English test, we don't realize this is happening. But what's happening to them is, you know what, I failed that test and I'm probably not smart enough to be here, and they just disappear. And we don't know they've disappeared until now with this intentional engagement model that we've implemented. So when that kid, or student, excuse me, is not successful and doesn't show up a couple times, then a message goes out and that person is calling them saying, hey, you know, what's going on? What happened? Why haven't you been to class? We've got a tutor. Come see me tomorrow and we'll set you up. And we, now that we have finished two semesters in this program, we have seen a tremendous difference in the success rates of our students. The first semester, we looked at the withdrawal rates when we got about three-fourths of the way into the semester, and our withdrawal rates had gone down by about roughly 25%, which is great. But then we had to sort of hold our breath till we got to the end of the semester, because if our withdrawal rates went down but our D's and F's went up, then we actually were not successful. We got to the end of the semesters, our D's and F's had not increased at all, but our A, B's, and C's had. So we have a program like this called Student Success that will sort of put their arms around these A students, because our goal is we need them to graduate, we need them to give back to the community, so that our economic development will prosper in Montgomery County. That's just a little bit about the program. I thought maybe you might have some questions that I can answer and explain more based on your questions.
Well, Angie, I've got one, and I'll make a very brief statement. The mentoring, the tutoring, great expectations. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of programs that the community college has here locally. I think that's across the state as well.
Right.
And what it really, I hope that, I'm so glad young people are in the audience. We are blessed in the Commonwealth of Virginia with the, what is my opinion is probably the best community college network in the country, bar none. If you look at transfer opportunities, transfer credits, it is really uncanny, and really it's unparalleled across the country. So I'm so thankful because again, a lot of the kids that I work with that are what I call fringe. When I say fringe, I mean that in terms of socioeconomic status. They don't have access. They don't have funds. They don't have, I hate to say, you know, not to be theoretical, but I mean, it's, they don't have hope.
Yeah.
And so when you invest in them, it's been my experience that it kind of brightens that, I guess, their outlook, and again, great things can be expected. But the first question I would have, though, again, so I really appreciate your efforts. I mean, I know you've already talked to the county, and you're doing what's necessary. Yeah. And I would imagine, again, with our law enforcement, I know they're always behind these types of initiatives because, again, I think their vision is, let's work with young kids and young people and get them hope here. Mm-hmm. That is going to decrease the opportunity or the necessity of us to work with them on the other side. And so that makes perfect sense. $300,000 was the expected necessity for year one through Montgomery County, and obviously Montgomery County, Blacksburg, Christiansburg. Are there any grant opportunities you all have recognized that would be applicable here in this area, grant opportunities?
Grant opportunities, not as much. We did write a Appalachian Region Commission grant for Radford.
Okay.
We haven't heard back from that yet. So as of right now, we don't have any other opportunities for grants.
So this will be straight line funded from the localities. Okay. And the other thing I wanted to ask you is the requirements, I think you said community service, and I think 2.5 community service financial application goes through you all. Can you give us just an idea, a flavor of what kind of community service, how these young people are giving back to the community that is investing in them? Some of the things they're doing. You said ditch digging and things like that. But.
Right, and in the city of Radford, and in each community we have a champion. So in Giles County, our champion was Chris Papardi, Board of Supervisors.
Okay.
And then in Floyd, it was Lavina Martin, Economic Development was our champion.
Right.
And then Radford is Rob Graham, who's the superintendent of schools. So it's kind of interesting how all this is falling because our champion in Montgomery County has been Chief Sisson and Chief Wilson and Sheriff Parton. So sort of, I think there's kind of a neat dynamic there. But Rob Graham's idea as superintendent of schools is he's dividing all of these A students up into groups of four, and each group will be assigned to one of their schools. And during the summer, they will get the school ready to open for the fall. They'll do all the mulching, they'll do all the cleaning, you know, any painting, all the things that's necessary. That'll be their duty for the summer, is to have the school ready. So, and we thought that would kind of have a neat little twist. It might make these young people appreciate more the importance of not having writing on the walls and keeping a clean school and the mulching and all that stuff. So.
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I would think, too, the increase of the school, the New River Community College at the mall,
yes,
is probably going to be a big incentive for you people and for kids here and young students coming out, that they have a place that they can go to without having to travel very far.
Correct, yes. Yeah. We were very excited to be able. We just expanded a little over 9,000 square feet there, I think.
Uh-huh.
So we've got plenty of space there for classes.
Well, I really like that connection, though, with workforce development.
Mm-hmm.
If there's one thing that we hear at our statewide conferences yearly, and regardless of what a party's in power or who the governor is, it's always preaching to the choir, workforce development in the localities. And, I mean, I think that is probably one of the strongest arguments I would imagine for this particular program. It's something we really have not failed on, but we've certainly struggled with as a community.
I do know, Angie, that the county at this point is looking at a program that is geared specifically toward first responders and their children or grandchildren. But the price tag of $300,000, if they get into this full-fledged, that means it's $600,000 a year thereafter, isn't it?
Actually, the program, they were looking at a way that they could start small and try to do something, and I've presented based actually on that topic a month or so ago in reference to the law enforcement, but the fire and rescue component. If they were to implement something like that, it's going to get quite complicated, because if it were only for the immediate family members of fire and rescue, and they were going to designate the volunteer work of the fire and rescue person, it wasn't fit. It's like sort of putting a square peg.
Okay, so that's changed now.
You know, the way I described it to them is, you know, we have so many teachable moments as a parent for our children. Kind of think of this ACE program as the same thing. So if we create something where the parents' community service counts, we're losing out on that teachable moment. So from what I understand, the $100,000 that they're putting in is not for the fire and rescue component.
Okay.
It is just for ACE. It was something that they thought hard about and was thinking of ways that they could reward the fire and rescue personnel. Okay. But it's anticipated full-blown program, $300,000 first year.
Now, do you all offer, I know you mentioned part of it, what I would consider a master trades program, which would include, in addition to mechanical drawings, and do you plumbing and electricity?
You do electricity.
A guy commented to me this weekend who owns a business. He said, I can't get two-year degree electricians to come in. And he said, they come in and make $50,000 to $70,000 a year. But we can't, he can't seem to get anybody in the college to work with him. So,
okay.
But anyway.
Okay.
Very good. Anything else?
Yeah, this is actually the second time I've heard this presentation. First time was at the Regional Commission.
Okay.
And which Harry Collins and I sit on. And Harry, I'm not sure if you were appointed there yet when we got to hear from the Giles County supervisors. Mm-hmm. I think it's Mr. McCoy who sits on the commission with me that, you know, there's always some sort of, you know, you're skeptical about these type of programs, especially in a public office, but he was very pleased with how this turned out, almost extremely pleased with it. And, you know, I've learned to trust a lot of the commissioners on there, and to hear that kind of testimony come from them that this is an incredible program for our youth and there'll be more benefit for our community, especially economic-wise. It was refreshing. So, in hopes that, you know, upon this presentation in the near future, maybe we can participate in this as well. That's my hope.
Yes, that's my hope as well.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. What I like about this program a lot is when you have a student who flunks a class or, you know, whatever, and you make them repay it. Mm-hmm. That's real life. That's good stuff. I mean, that's really good stuff.
It's accountability.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, we all know, we all taken college classes, and I've heard lots of conversations about kids not doing so well, and then when they suddenly have to pay the bill themselves, they get a little more serious about it.
That's
so
right.
So even though they're not paying the bill themselves up front, they do know that if they're not successful. And we have so many safety nets in place. The connection specialist, our office, we do everything that we can to save them from that.
Have you worked out what percentage of the folks actually could and you want to, like, Virginia Tech or to
a four-year university?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, actually, because of our dual enrollment, we have so many students who participate. If there's any seniors in here, mm-hmm. you may have taken some dual enrollment classes at your high school at New River. But we had a couple students graduate from New River the first year because they had taken so many dual enrollment, and they've transferred on to a four-year university.
Okay,
well, I'm looking forward to getting through this semester, and then we'll have 2 years under our belt with Giles County, and we'll have some really good numbers.
Well, I'm glad that the school systems are beginning to recognize that not every student that comes into the high schools is going to go to Harvard or Yale, and that there is a need for this specialized training, and I think it's excellent. And I agree with Henry. I'd like to see us be able to get on board with something.
I have a statistic. It's a 2018, or Harvard predicts in 2018 that only 33% of all jobs will require a four-year degree or more, while the overwhelmingly majority will be middle-skilled jobs requiring technical skills and training at the credential or associate degree level. So does it mean that you don't want your children to have those bachelor's degrees and master's and PhDs, but we have students who come back to our college with bachelor's degrees because they need a skill.
Yeah.
And then they've got a big debt to pay.
So. Very good. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
A degree in sociology will just take you for so far, is that correct?
That's correct, yeah. And our instrumentation graduates, oh my goodness, the money that they make. I mean, they're 19, 20 years old, graduate with a two-year instrumentation degree. We've had kids come back to our college. They pulled some overtime. They were making six digits. Of course, they were driving the biggest diesel four-wheeled drive pickup that you could purchase. You know, we try to give them a little talk about saving some of that money, but 19, 20, they don't necessarily get that to start with.
Very good. Any other questions or comments? Thank you, Angie.
Thank
I'm
you
sure
for
I'll see you in a couple of meetings this week. It's a school night, folks. If you need to get your kids home, even though it's 2 hours late, it's still a school night. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you all for having us. Thank you.
Good to see you.
It is 2 hours late, but I got to get my extra sleep.
2 hours late, but I'm
fine. Exactly. Got to fire up.
Watch the weather. Yeah. Thank
good
you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
All right, as we are quietly clearing the room, get another minute or two, get down to the nitty gritty, get on with
it. It's really gracious, everybody's gone.
It's okay. Next, hey Mark. Yeah, thank you. Dave, you'll just kind of take the doors closed until we can get the hallway cleared out. Not a closed session meeting, but they do kind of like to sit and talk in the background. Next on our agenda is Sue Farrar, Executive Director of the Montgomery Museum, Lewis Miller Regional Arts Center, regarding 2017 events. Sue?
I thank you.
Jumped up there pretty quick.
Alas, I have no gifts. I'm sorry.
Let's make this quick.
Yeah, I'm bringing good news, and I think we'll be very brief. This is not my annual report for you, so I'm just talking about some specific things tonight. And I do want to say that I appreciate that now all members of the council are members of the museum, and I thank you for that. We're grateful for your support, and we appreciate it. And we coerced the last one and arm twisted, and every one of you is now a member of the museum, and I'm thankful. And I love the youth. This is exciting. And we have now an exhibit from Auburn High School students, and then the Christiansburg High School will come in 1st of April. So I encourage you all to come see what they do. The work is awesome, and they do 2D and 3D, and we'll be happy to have you there. We have a reception, and maybe you'll find it when that is and be able to come in and enjoy their work. What I wanted to just talk to you a little bit tonight is the events coming up that involve council and your approval. We have given, I think everybody has this. It's part of a sponsorship solicitation package.
Anybody I didn't get to?
Our events. Everybody get one? Just to keep you from having to make a note or anything.
You want to give me one?
Yeah. We've submitted all the paperwork.
We got it.
You want? I can remember what we're doing.
Okay.
We've submitted the paperwork, and I just need to get approval from council for several of the events. The first one is May 20th, and it is the cruise-in. We did this last year with Dale Eccles and those classic cars that come in all shiny and wonderful, and you look at my engine and I'll look at your engine and whatever they do. And it's an event that we don't make a lot of money on this, but it's a nice event for us to promote the town and the council. We don't need any staging or any movement in town. I just want you to be aware that we'll be talking about how this is going to work. I submitted the paperwork, and so I know we'll be talking about the whatever the security is needed and so forth. It seems that Dale Eccles organizes most of that. We'll be selling some drinks and snacks and things like that. Hopefully we'll have some music if we can find some power on the poles downtown and pipe in some music, so we'll be talking about that too. The big event is June 17th, which we had last year. It's the Mountains of Music Crooked Road event, and we will ask for help from the town on that. We would like to have a stage, and we're partnering with Ignite on both of these events and using their facilities, and we're partnering with Ignite on some other things, which will come in a later report. But they are the most community-minded people that Christiansburg has seen in a long time, and the museum seems to be benefiting a lot from their generosity. So things will happen on June 17th. There'll be a stage, and we would like to barricade the streets, and we'd like to sell beer and wine, and we will have four live bands free during the day, and then we'll have a ticketed event inside the hall at Ignite, which will be a Crooked Road sponsored event for a ticket. And that's the main thing we want to ask is that the town help us do that. You also see we have Heritage Day, which doesn't involve downtown, and mm-hmm. we hope some of you will come and eat and test pies and we're looking forward to that. And the current thing that's coming up is an event at Ignite. It'll be the first event in the building, which is Scott Crawford doing a talk. And I don't know if you all know about it, but if you don't, please call the museum. I think it's something you might not want to miss. And it'll be their first event for the public. And I did go look today, and there's going to be a floor, and they have painted, and we'll get in. And that's going to be a real nice event. So,
and what's the topic again?
He is talking about Gilbert Stuart's painting of George Washington the night before he retired, which I didn't know presidents did, which I think so. But he pulls out just incredible facts, and he's very, very exciting and energetic, and it's okay, far thanks. From dull. So,
and what is the date on that?
23rd March. That's next Thursday.
It's $20 a ticket. I think you're working with the Kiwanis Club, yeah, kind of in sponsorship
Club
with them.
Yeah, Kiwanis Club is helping sponsor that. They do every year, and so this looks like a bigger event. We might make a little money on that. We're working hard to increase the things we do that raise money, and as always, we thank you for your support, which is most generous. That's another thing.
So is March 23rd on your website?
Yes.
Okay.
It's all over Facebook.
I guess the very first one you had with the Holiday Inn with Kiwanis Club.
We did it long before the Kiwanis Club.
Really?
Mm-hmm. We've been doing this 5 or 6 years.
Okay. Well, I went to one of them, and it was very good. I would highly recommend.
Yeah.
It's a good entertainment, a good evening.
Yeah.
I mean,
we'll have better food this year.
Very good.
So
we can top a Holiday Inn.
So you get some food and wine and get to listen to Scott Crawford.
Right.
And it starts at what time?
Starts at 6.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And this will probably be the first thing that's in
the first thing that's,
the very
that's
first
happening
thing,
in the old. It's in the old Gothic.
Gives a chance to look at it, you know.
So that's mm-hmm. Thursday night.
Next Thursday.
And so I'm sorry, and the location for this particular event is?
Mm-hmm. Old Baptist Church.
Right, the Ignite.
We're having a wine event in the Old Baptist Church.
That's right.
My grandmother would turn over in her grave, but that's okay.
I was going to say, we've been going to
Gothic Hall. Gothic Hall.
Gothic Hall.
It's the oldest
right.
building.
Well, we have some meetings that are taking place in Ignite right now. We have every time we go there, we get a chance to kind of see what's been done.
Right.
And every time, you're always astounded because so much has been done in the short amount of time since the last time you saw it.
Yeah. This was amazing.
It's something else. It's very unique.
Right.
And you can buy tickets right there at the door.
You have to make a reservation.
Okay.
We have to know numbers. This is new.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So are there any questions from you all about any of the events and of your support, what we're about to do?
I think
we're working very hard.
It's obvious.
And I guess, Andrew, these permits will come, these requests will come to us as in the normal process through planning and recreation?
Correct. Right. The grants will come through the grants committee and with the grant process with Charlton heading up the more logistics side of it to estimate the costs, the town costs to be in those.
Okay.
And Randy, please chime in, but then those would come to you for official street closure approval.
Well, I don't know that I can speak for all of Council, Sue, but you haven't told me anything tonight that scared me away.
I'm so happy to know that. Thank you.
One thing I'd like to mention.
You submitted all of the application paperwork and everything.
Okay.
We'll be looking forward to hearing from you.
I think it's terrific what the museum's doing. That's
my first part, but my second part is, Mr. Biggs, these dates, these are great dates to get with Public Works and make sure we get those light bulb banners up of the museum so we can recognize them downtown.
I hope you say that.
Thank you.
And banners across the street, you know, we don't want to run through the thing we had last year, but anyway. All right, very good. Any other questions or comments for Sue?
We told the Kiwanis Club last week about Wilderness Trail. We haven't voted on it yet, but I'll say it again. I anticipate a favorable outcome.
There you go.
I anticipate that.
We gave him a definite maybe, Sue, so there you go.
So do you want to introduce Kim?
Yeah, my board member, Kim Harris. Yeah. Thank you.
Moral support for Sue. Yeah. Just like to reiterate our appreciation for all the support, invaluable support from the town.
Thank you.
It's going to be continuing, I'm certain, and you'll all have a good time, I'm sure, when you come to the events.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, you know, Dave, I guess we can go ahead and, unless there's still a crowd in the hallway, this has the appearance of a closed session, so can we get a door open somewhere along the line? All righty, thank you. Next on the agenda is the old business, and it's counts a request for street closing for the Wilderness Trail Festival. Request was presented to council February 28, 2017 by the Kiwanis Club.
Mr. Mayor, I've heard nothing in regards to there being problems with what was requested before, so I would move that we recognize and approve the street closing for the Wilderness Trail Festival as presented.
I second it.
Motion is second. Any discussion?
Just make sure I've taken it there hasn't been anything that has been brought forth that's been inappropriate or any businesses that have had a problem whatsoever.
No, so the events committee is comfortable with the application of street closure and have indicated to us that what's been communicated to them is alcohol sales will not be a factor this year.
All right. Very good.
Very good. We have a motion and a second, and I think there's some more discussion. Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0. Thank you. In your recording, Mr. Bishop is being absent. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Discussion of potential action regarding the revised employee handbook. Council reviewed and discussed the handbook revisions during a work session March 7th, 2017. Mr. Biggs, is that yours?
Mr. Mayor, the pleasure of the council. We had the work session. If there are follow-up questions, I remember at one point during our work session, there was a question raised having to do with the policy regarding driver's license. But by the end of the meeting, I felt like possibly that had been resolved.
Indeed.
So I don't know that if there are any other open issues that you need to report on. Mr. Bromstad certainly is present and prepared. But otherwise, we feel like there's been a good process here. It's been a very broadly inclusive process, and we feel confident about the product we brought to you for your approval.
Mr. Mayor, unless there's somebody else has a question, great meeting, very informative, very thorough, and no stone was left unturned, in my opinion, from the research that went into that. I would move that we approve the revised employee handbook as presented. Back on March 7th.
I second that too.
We have a motion and a second. Any comments or discussion?
I'd like to commend Sir Wanstead as well, Mr. Biggs, and everyone who had a part of that because
Mr. Gwynn was involved.
Mr. Gwynn, it was thorough and professional, and we made some pretty significant changes. We covered a lot of turf in our work session, but that's because of the work that you all did, and with heartfelt appreciation to you all. That was quite an accomplishment, so thank you.
And the only recommendation I have, just more than 10 font. That's that.
I just wanted to thank council.
Absolutely.
Very good. All right, so motion second. Comments are done. Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That would be 5-0. Thank you very much. Discussion, appointment of New River Valley Solid Waste Authority. Mr. Biggs, you were working on that for us?
Mr. Mayor, had a meeting set with Mr. Helms last Thursday. Unfortunately, that meeting had to be rescheduled, so I have not met with him. I did prefer to handle this matter face-to-face. I sent him a note just this afternoon, just in case, you know, kind of circle back to him through other sources that he'd know what was going on, but we had intended to meet last Thursday and discuss it. We canceled that meeting. I feel confident that we can get a meeting face-to-face rescheduled between now and the 28th. Based on what you previously indicated in terms of the budget process with this particular group, I don't think this affects our appointment process.
Right. Yeah, I think that that budget should be wrapped up by the end of May. The public comments is on it. It's coming up for the April meeting, and then they'll vote on it in May, and that's done. And
well, Mr. Mayor, if it pleases council, I just would move that we stay item C until the 28th. I agree with Mr. Biggs. I think it needs to be face-to-face communicated with Mr. Helms. But I would move that we stay item C until the next meeting, which will be on the 28th of this month.
Okay.
Second.
Motion second. Discussions, comments? Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0. Thank you very much. Report Christopher High School student involvement in local government. I attached an email to you all today that kind of had the synopsis of Mr. Collins and I meeting with Tony Deaver. I haven't heard back from them yet, but the ball is kind of in their court at this point. And there's not much more than that. Mr. Hall, you had a couple of comments today.
I feel like I've lived it. We've had some issues with a student that I work with, and I feel like I've lived at high school recently and had some meetings with Tony and Shane and a guidance department. We actually have to subpoena two of them. I have not mentioned a word about this. I don't feel like that's my position to do that. That's Harry, and that's your mayor. That's your item you're working with, but I'll be up there again a couple times this week, and if it's be okay, I'll just mention them. Hey, I know that we've sent something to you to kind of get the ball rolling. Any idea when we maybe might hear back? I think, again, we're not trying to push this at all, but I'd love to have something set up where we can look at this in the fall.
I can talk to him anyway, so if you want, like, I can call him tomorrow and find out.
Well, I think what I would like to do at this point, since Harry, you and I got it started,
okay.
I would like to step away and maybe let Mr. Hall serve as the co-liaison to get things ready.
With Mr. Collins?
Yeah.
Okay. No, that'd be great.
My schedule seems to be getting more and more filled every time, so if you could get me out of a meeting or so, I would appreciate it. So that'll work well.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Since we're just looking into it, one of the things, you know, I'm in school with JA as well, and, you know, just looking at if we could look at a less traditional role, meaning placing one student up here, because the court's familiar with this, the authorizations you have to get from their parents and things like that, and their role here. I would like some sort of the conversation to at least envelop maybe a school advisory board where you kind of put that instead of us, you know, you're responsible for this, we can give them, if they're interested, they can do it in one of their government classes and sort of create a, you know, ad hoc advisory board amongst the students that a teacher's in charge of, and we can give them specific directions, and we can even meet with them once, maybe twice a year.
Why don't you help us?
A work session. I'm not going to step into it because
we all have
you've
meeting.
Got the job on now.
Never mind.
I'm just throwing it out there. Instead of a lot of work that we have to do and we have to wrangle and we have to, you know, you create that could be a government class project on an annual basis. I'm just saying, throw it out there and see what they say.
Yeah. And Harry, I'm certain that before the 28th, that Harry and I could get together with the school on a schedule that's convenient with them and kind of gauge their interest again and see maybe something like that. my whole purpose of doing, trying to do this and working on this is to have involvement. Mm-hmm. And so if I know that just from our committees where we have the students involved, sometimes they get a little nervous, sometimes they feel a little overwhelmed, and I don't want to push them into that. It's like tonight trying to get a few of them to talk about their paintings. Mary did a good job in trying to do that, but they're reluctant. But then again, as part of an ad hoc advisory group, they very well may have, I should say ad hoc, really an advisory group, they may have a lot of more strength with one another, and maybe that would be even more beneficial.
Well, you're on their turf. I'm just that's right. thinking
that's
something
right.
else.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
Good idea. Yeah. But, and we'll just be open.
Yeah.
Whatever they want to look at.
You know, another thing to look into, when I was in the school system, they had a student body, and they usually had a president of the student body.
Right.
And I'm not sure they probably still have that now. Mm-hmm. I think that would be a natural job for the guy who's the head of the student body, maybe to be the spokesman, and they had that job for 1 year, and he could be. He probably knows more about what's going on the school than anything else. That might be something you might want to look into.
And we can, and what we'll do, Mr. Mayor, if it pleases council. Harry and I will just make sure that at each meeting subsequent to this one, we will give a 2-minute update as to where we're at. And
yeah.
Some meetings, they're not going to be anything.
Well, the canvas is mm-hmm. is clear.
That's right.
And the we can paint the picture as we see fit. And we may not get it right the first time, mm-hmm. but right. we don't know until we try.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
the whole thing about it.
Yeah.
So, all right. Thank you, Mr. Collins.
Yes, thank you. I'm appreciate all the comment
on that. Board. Absolutely.
Sir,
I look forward to it.
Yeah, this stuff is great, really. That's important stuff.
Excuse me. Yes, sir.
One last comment, since Mr. Showalter is making a suggestion, I'll make another one. When I was in Blacksburg High School, actually, we had that program going on at the time. I don't know if Blacksburg still does it, but actually, another recommendation to you all as you're formulating what this thing's going to look like and how it's going to work, we could offer to assign them some things to consider. Mm-hmm. And a recent example is the wrestling team. How can we recognize the wrestling team?
Yep.
Isn't that a good idea?
Yeah. I mean, give them
some
tasks to, mm-hmm. To work
yeah.
on.
Yeah.
And come back to us with some recommendations. Meaningful recommendations.
Yeah.
How can, but, maybe, so it's not just an advisory, but we're actually assigning them some. Then there's,
yeah,
the list is endless, but we could come up
yeah,
with,
yeah.
Items for them to pursue.
That's a great idea.
If you all would, and I think maybe after Harry and I met, I sent out an email asking for your comments.
Yeah.
So if you get a chance, would you email me back these things so we'll have it all right?
Henry did send out some stuff. I got your stuff that you sent out on it.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, just so
yeah, okay.
we all have it out
yeah.
there, so we can
yeah.
throw it off the wall. All right. Thank you. Next is a report to Christiansburg High School Wrestling Program State Championship. Mr. Collins.
Okay, sir. A bunch of us met this morning. The police were there. The first aid squad was there. The rec center folks handled parade stuff, and we just worked out the time, the route, where the trucks would be placed, when they come, to set up for the parade and that kind of stuff. And Sheila's going to provide the trucks, and there might be a lot of trucks, here, but they said that's okay. And any person who drives one of the trucks, we have to go there to sign something, for anything, for insurance purposes, that kind of thing. And the most important thing that so we still have to do is to get with the high school, because it's really up to them to get the people's names, make sure they're coming. Without that, we don't have a parade, so I'll be calling him tomorrow, and we can do the other stuff too at the same time.
Sure.
Any other questions, Colin? Henry, I think we have your suggestion on file about the banners. You said that we've got that. I've got that in the guts of some of the stuff we have. So putting the banners up a couple of weeks before, and hey, I believe the banner across the street, there's some guidelines on it that
yes,
we
sir.
Want to work on.
Yes, sir.
Can I just hammer sure. one point home? You got to get those students involved. You got to get the wrestling club involved.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
You can have as many yeah. trucks as you want, as many banners as you want, and we can be here at council behind it. But unless their parents and the students show up, you said it, there's no parade.
That's right.
So they have to.
Yeah.
Be involved in this. They have to be spreading the word.
That's
get it
right.
out there.
It's going to be at the same time. That would have the opening of the farmers market, farmer's market the same night.
Well, what date is that? Once more? May?
May 4th.
May 4th. May 4th.
You're right up on us.
Yeah, I mentioned to Harry that maybe, you know, when they have the Olympics, they have somebody's a student with a sign saying this is the United States and this is Guatemala or something like that, that maybe they could do a sign like that, a little sign like this saying 2000. And then anybody who's on that team.
I'm sure that they will probably decorate the track accordingly. But yeah, I mean that's right.
You
yeah.
just sort of have a just you know progression.
So we'll do that.
2016. Yeah.
From
yeah.
oldest to youngest.
Hopefully get the art department at the school to make a signs for us.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah, there you go.
Got a lot of hoping to do in about a month and a half.
You're right.
All right.
Yeah.
I will say you know there's been some talk and I've had some communication from some citizens about the signage, and I had the occasion to speak with Mayor Brown out of Bradford, and of course, you know, they just won a state basketball championship, and I said, well, did you all put the sign up, pay for it? He said, no. He said, the school, that's their responsibility and the clubs to come up with the signage, and I said, well, you know, we're going to get behind this thing and work toward it and probably some financial, but I mean, I just everybody thinks for some reason that it's up to the town. Maybe that was Scoop's jaded article. I don't know. Well, but I think we need to be involved in it, obviously. But there is more than just the town.
I'd like to see the clubs and or the you know the wrestling club. They've always said they would support that, but.
Because we got others. I mean, in my vision would not be just a wrestling state championship board.
Oh, absolutely
It would be way back, even as far back as I can remember. The 1957 track team was a state champion, and Brad, your son played on a state basketball championship. Yeah. So, I mean, it's an encompassing board.
Yeah. And I just want to say too that this all got traction from Marty's newspaper article, and I appreciate that seriously.
Not much. Very good.
Can we put Marty in charge? Marty, you want to be put in charge of this?
I'm volunteering with Harry anytime he needs me.
I think we need to be slow about it. I've seen Radford sign a few times, but you almost have to be right up next to it in order to read anything.
It would take you 30 minutes to read it. Or something.
Right. So we've got time to get it right. Sure. So.
Very good. Any other old business?
No.
Under new business, the reappointment of John Overton to the Montgomery County Economic Development Commission.
No report unless you need one there, administrative item.
We have asked for his attendance. Did we ever get that?
I'm not aware that we...
Well, I think I sent that back to Brenda Rigney, or whoever's involved in that, and asked for his attendance record
we'll
over
follow
last
up on
year.
That. I was unaware of that.
I'm sitting on that as of the fall, and he was at our last meeting. The first two meetings that I was at, he was not there, and of course I missed one with my back surgery in January. But if it's council's pleasure to consider that, I can only speak to the last 3 or 4 months, because that's when you appointed me to that board. So.
He's not here tonight, right?
He's not here this evening.
So I would rather table this until he is here.
Do we get the facts and figures? He's interested in serving again. I haven't followed up.
I'm not sure if anyone spoken with him about this.
No, sir.
Okay, that might be.
That's the next move.
Yeah. Very good. Okay.
Committee reports. Street committee reports. Recommendations on. Yeah. Four things?
Yes, we do. We're going to move quickly. There is something neat we want to show you, but we are proposing from heretofore to go paperless, and Mr. Warren is prepared to do that this evening.
Oh,
and so we're not going to do the passing out anymore.
Plat for records, Kensington Phase 4.
Yes, and as he's bringing that up, y'all are familiar with Kensington, and this is a new phase. 15 home sites. That's right up near the water tank. It's all called Diana Drive, and we won't belabor. We've got we don't want to belabor the point. The street committee considered this.
This is Fralin.
This is Fralin. And this is beyond the PRD that we did before, the planned residential development. And these 15 lots are R1, and they conform to our ordinance. And Mr. Nelson and the engineering department have assured us all the safeguards in place to make sure that, you know, that the road is paved before any certificates of occupancy are issued and so forth, and that they're, you know, the construction traffic that's been a problem in the past, the town is committed to watching this a lot more carefully than to make sure that we don't experience, history doesn't repeat itself. So without belaboring the point, these are 15 lots. Andrew, can you show sort of where the water tank is so people get familiar with it? Yeah. Water tank's there, and the middle school's on the other side of the water tank. So if you go up to there today, that is sort of graded and roughed out. You can sort of see where it is. But 15 lots, R1, conforms with the ordinance, and the street committee recommends approval of the plat as presented, and that recommendation is made in the form of a motion.
I'll second. Motion and a second.
And there is before you vote on it, there is a lot of open space on that for the future as well. I think, how many acres was it, Andrew, roughly?
It's almost 12 acres.
How much?
Almost 12 acres.
Almost 12 acres. So everything you see behind the house, you see the remaining 13 acres or something, that's all open space.
Is that intended to remain open space, Brad, or is that?
It is. No, it's not. It's got some terrain to it. But it is open, and I hope we see more developments like that, where you have smaller lots and more open space.
They have a steep decline there?
Yes.
Yeah. I haven't been up there, Andrew, very much in the near past, but everything is looking all right, you don't have any heartaches about anything that they're doing up there?
I know that we've been addressing it on a phase-by-phase basis. And we are working with them on inspections, and I know that it is improving, and we continue to work with them. I'm not sure if Mr. Nelson has anything to add.
We've been communicating our dissatisfaction with certain aspects of the development, and they are showing interest in working with us and are doing a better job.
Can you elaborate on that, or do you want to?
Well, mainly in regards to erosion sediment control inspections and particular street construction, communicating what we're looking for, what will be acceptable, what won't be. We are working on improved guidelines for all developers, and we'll have that here in the near future.
I believe, Brad, that's what you were alluding to before we dealt with the street issue, if I recall.
This will be the third development that this particular developer has done, and the first two are misses, quite honestly. New River Village and Windsor Estates, we've had problems, and in Kensington showed signs of that as recently as a year and a half ago in August. We took those pictures. Mm-hmm. So, quite honestly, I hate to put it bluntly, but I'm counting on the engineering department in the town to, you know, to show their teeth on this and make sure this is done right. We welcome Mr. Fralin, and we welcome any developer to do this, but we cannot be like the pooper scooper behind the elephant in a parade and cleaning up behind these messes. We just cannot do it. And that those days are in the past, and so, quite put it bluntly, I think we have to be, and if we need to hire somebody to, you know, or put a camera out there and watch for no trucks out there, whatever you need to do that, I think it's safe to say you're going to have council support for that.
Everyone has to clear it as he does each phase, right? Does he have to clear it with you people before he can move on?
Yes.
There are construction plans that go along with each phase.
What we have is certificates of occupancy. If they can't get COs, then they're, you know, that's the disincentive. But anyway, we don't want to believe we've got a lot of things covered.
One more thing, Brad. I agree with what he just said, though. Council supports you on this, and anything that you feel is not going correctly or they're smoothing through it too fast, we will support you. I think I can say that for everybody here on council.
Thank you. I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Yes, second.
Motion and a second. Certainly there's no more discussion. If there is, it's welcome, but anyway. Madam Clerk.
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
That is 5-0. Thank you.
Okay.
Next is the right-of-way dedication plat records of Halberstadt Family Limited Partnership, located off of Quinn W. Stewart Boulevard.
Council will remember last year we approved the rezoning for apartments and pretty dense development in here, but it looks like it's coming along fine. The particular plat before you is a plat that encompasses 188 units, a mix of apartments and single-family houses that I think Stateson is going to be doing the single families anyway, correct? Okay, so the plat is presented. We did discuss it in a lot further detail. What you see up there is basically the boundary of it, and what you see, the shaded areas are all utility easements and so forth. The access road is along the top of the sheet, along the east side of the property, and that road separates this new development from actually the Villas at Pepper's Ferry. So this, and then on the south side, or excuse me, the bottom of the sheet, or the west side, you see Stafford Drive. So there, that sort of gets you oriented. So the plat conforms with our zoning ordinance. The staff has reviewed it, and we discuss it in greater detail than we would like to right now. So the plat is presented for approval, and I may also make a recommendation that the street committee recommends that this plat be approved as presented, and that recommendation is made in the form of a motion.
Question here.
This can I have a second?
Okay. Second.
I'm sorry.
Now comments.
Okay. This is where they said that they would put in finance part of the light, put in $200,000.
Yes, this was the trigger. If you want to know, this is the tipping point.
Okay.
This particular development was a tipping point to justify, to provide the warrants.
That's right.
To trip the signal, no pun intended.
and that's Quinn Stewart Boulevard, Brad. I don't see very
Quinn Stewart is on
the right side.
That's correct.
So that just give us an orientation.
That's correct.
And there's Stafford on the bottom there.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
And they are still locked in on that. On how is that? It's working with VDOT and them about concerning the light and paying for it.
It's about
money.
A third, I think, thirds.
How does that work? Is
something
anybody
like that.
Familiar with that?
Well, it's revenue sharing. We're using revenue sharing.
For the traffic signal.
How's the funding?
That's revenue sharing.
It's all okay, so the town doesn't have any dollars in there then.
Revenue sharing is 50-50.
Yeah. Right, I know that, but is a developer, they're limited to what, 200 and?
Quarter up to 250,000.
Quarter up to 250, so it's 25 or up to 250 of their money, and then 25% of our money?
Yes.
And then another 50% from VDOT. So, yeah, there's a three-way partnership.
Our numbers are around seven figures, I recall, for that stoplight.
And after that, when do they have to put up the money, and when does the light go in?
It's based on the number of units. It's
the number of units, or when number they are completed, then they have to put the light in.
Well,
and that's pretty much in writing, too, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The council felt comfortable going ahead with the light before those units came in.
It basically
is what I remember.
To put the light in, they're going to reimburse us.
So what is this? I think
anticipation of them hitting that point in the next year or so.
Okay.
How much was the light again?
Probably $800,000.
We haven't bid it yet. We've issued an RFP,
a
request for proposals for engineer, and we have selected a firm, and we're negotiating that contract.
Okay.
Harry, I think they said. The builders here that they would get put up $200,000, as I recall.
Up to $250,000.
$250,000.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Any other questions? Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
It's 5-0. Thank you. Right-of-way dedication for a new street, John Adams Drive Northwest, and temporary turnaround easement dedication for 0.174 acres of tax parcel 435A40 from Snyder Hunt Company, LLP, to the town of Christiansburg, located off Quinn W. Stewart Boulevard.
Okay, this is the road that we looked at on the last sketch. This is the road between the proposed development, which is on the bottom of the sheet, and existing
villas
at Pepper's Ferry on the upper side. The street committee reviewed this some time ago, and they a recommendation that we had made for a turnaround at the end, the area you see on the left, area for a temporary turnaround to make sure that if tomorrow never came and they never finished their development, that there'd still be a cul-de-sac back there for our public use. So this reflects several months ago discussion with council and action by, actually we acted on this to some extent. What was the action we took, Andrew, previously?
The action was actually approval last March, and there is a 60-day time frame that if it does not come to final plat after
council approves
it, then it is expired.
Okay.
So this has to come back to you.
So this is a reapproval. That's what it was. I'm sorry. So this is a reapproval of something that council's already acted on in the past. So I'll make a street committee recommends that council approve this request. I'll make that recommendation in the form of a motion.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion?
One quick question. The construction access for the development of that property, I should have asked this at the last, is that's not going to be via, of course, Shepherd, and it's not going to be via Quinn, correct?
That's a good question. Mr. Nelson?
I mean, Shepherd was our concern because of the narrowness, of course, but...
Stafford?
You mean Stafford.
Stafford.
Yeah, okay.
I recall there was another access point, I believe we were looking at, for them to do construction vehicles. I should have asked this last one. I didn't.
Where's the construction access for this proposed development?
I'm not familiar with that at this point.
Okay.
I would have to look specifically, but I know that there was language that said that it could not be through the village development. And I believe that it did allow for Quinn Stewart Boulevard, but not Stafford.
Okay, not Stafford, but through Quinn Stewart, not through the Villas.
Correct.
Okay. Not through the Villas, that's a good point. Okay, hopefully people are hearing those comments, yeah.
I would like to say there is so much going on in this area, or so much potential to be going on. I think it would be good that somebody, maybe Andrew, if you could come maybe every 6 months or something like that and say, well, this is what they're doing and this is how far they've progressed and give us an update, because there's a lot going on here, or have a lot of potential. And I think that we should be, keep on top of it. If nothing else, Andrew, give me a call. And I'd just like to listen to you go over there, okay?
Let's go that route initially.
I will add on your consent agenda, there is a rezoning proposal for 8 acres, as well as following with a conditional use permit for planned residential development. That would take 8 acres really to the left here on your screen to townhome developments. So that's actually going to be coming to you in the next about a month and a half. I think April 25th is your scheduled public hearing.
If not, you can take me out to lunch and we'll go over there, okay?
We're good.
Okay.
All right. Let's set all the discussion. Madam Clark.
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
All right. That's 5-0. Thank you very much. Recommendation of speed limit for curve at Carson Drive and Robin Road.
Okay, we've had this on our agenda for probably at least 3 meetings, maybe 4, going back to December. And simply put, Mr. Nelson and the engineering department are responding to a citizen request for the safety of a existing intersection. It functions as a curve, but it's actually a street intersection that through the years has developed into a curve at the intersection of Carson and Robin. And simply put, without belaboring the point, the final action on this was a staff recommendation to assign additional, the street committee recommended that the town consider reduced speed around the curve signs in addition to the speed limit signs that are out there. And also, they've engaged a property owner that there's a shrub that you'll see on here. But we thought the council would like to see a new trick that the staff has learned. And actually, in my 28 years of practice, I learned something too. But I'll turn it over to Mr. Nelson to show, and then we'll go over the recommendations.
Sure. I'll show you my app here. It's
Street committee. Oh, you can't show it on the screen.
Oh, I will.
Oh, okay.
I want to show you what's here on my phone.
And this is an approved method from Federal Highway Administration, and this is actually what VDOT does when they have similar concerns about what speed should they post on a curve.
So we were informed of a device called a fall bank indicator. Told VDOT had one. They use it to determine the safe speed when you navigate a curve. So I called VDOT. They had one in Salem. They had someone that knew how to operate it, but they wouldn't be up here anytime soon. We heard it was around $100, so we looked into that, but due to the diligence of staff, we found that there's a free app that you can put on your iPhone that we got.
Wait,
so we spent $5 on a bracket to mount it to your dashboard. I want to show you what it looks like. It measures degrees, ball bank indicator degrees, and with this app, you can it records it, and you have a GPS map here in the lower right corner. So you can just take a look at it. What it does is measure the degree, and it's a function of your speed, centripetal force, and really you determine the angle at which it's comfortable for a driver to navigate a curve. In this case, where we have 25 mile per hour,
thanks, sir.
Federal Highway Administration recommends a ball bank indicator reading of no more than 16.
That's pretty cool.
And as you will see, we were maxing out at 20 plus, anywhere from 15 to 20 miles per hour. So we're recommending a speed of 10 miles per hour on this curve.
Yeah, you can navigate it, at 25, and thanks to it. But I think the neat thing about what the engineering department's doing is that we can do this throughout town now. We can do what VDOT does.
So you're traveling west on Carson Drive, approaching the curve.
Yeah.
And it's registering your speed. And the angle's maxed out. It takes a while. We ran five different scenarios, but it takes a little while to load it up. So I just wanted to show you that one.
Wow.
That's neat stuff.
One video.
That's excellent.
It really is.
So the street committee is formally recommended to council that first of all, to recognize the engineering department's work on here. See the center lane lines, we've done that, or they did that. Public Works put the center lane lines in, which have been effective in other neighborhoods.
Yes.
They also put new chevrons up there, which indicate the curve, but we're taking it one more step and putting some advisory signage up there for that curve that'll bring additional attention to it. Plus, we're hoping that the property owner at the corner there is going to trim their bushes back because it's in the right-of-way, and they said that they would. So that's our recommendation. The street committee recommends that council authorize the engineering and public works department to install the signs for an advisory sign or advisory speed of 10 miles per hour for that curve.
I second it.
Any comments, questions?
I know everybody will feel blessed. I have no comments or questions about it, but I do think this is amazing.
I do too. Thank you. Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0. Thank you very much. And I want to comment and compliment the going of paperless on these things, because if you ever watch the replay of our council meetings under the old session, you heard a lot of flipping and waving and a lot of stuff. So that helps quite a bit, because these microphones are very sensitive.
Well, and the audience can also see.
I think that's the important part of it. Very good. Staff reports. Mr. Biggs?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, just a report on the item, and what we'll do is we'll track this through our next meeting, and I can also include the hard copy of what I have here for you with our upcoming update. But the BML, as you're probably aware, has a number of policy committees. They utilize these policy committees in order to formulate their legislative program. They have a policy committee for community and economic development, environmental quality, finance, general laws, human development and education, and transportation. And wanted to check the interest of council in making nominations for appointment to these groups. They do have a few rules or guidelines associated with them. Only governing body members and appointed officials may represent the town. In other words, not citizens. As long as they're an employer or elected official, then they're eligible to serve. If we do nominate two people to a committee, which is our right, at least one of the two should be a governing body member. Individuals can only serve on one committee per year, and importantly, the nominations have to be in by April 14th. So we've got some time to give some deliberation to this. I do think it's important that Christiansburg be engaged with VML. There's a lot of advantage to that in terms of knowledge base and prestige and networking. And so if you'll kind of think through, and like I said, I'll run a scan of the hard copy here so that at your leisure you can read it a little more in detail, and then we'll include it on the meeting agenda for the 28th.
I think in the past I've served on transportation, but my term may have expired. But they meet in Richmond usually, and it's not a usually not a weekend meeting. So
no, it's you're right. It's not convenient for working people, I can tell you.
So
I agree with Mr. Biggs, and I also served on the transportation. In fact, one year I was vice chairman of it, but attending a meeting in Richmond was sort of a challenge. And they don't meet that frequently, once or twice a year.
Yeah, I think so. A lot of around policy time. So we'll do some thinking on this, and we'll try to at least bring it back before, just as a reminder, on the 28th, that we would still have, I think, another meeting prior to this thing having to be in. So that's just something to look at. Michelle, so we got a lot of these things for us, but they didn't have any type of a proposed meeting schedule or, okay.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Very good.
That's the only report.
That's it. Thank you, Mr. Biggs. Mr. Gwynn?
No report.
Any other staff members here other than we have Val here for a an amendment to the annual budget for 16-17? Terry, you're for some.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Okay. Hopefully you had a chance to read through this. I won't belabor it too much. I just wanted to kind of run over a quick summary of what was in it and see if you had any questions, if there was anything I could clarify with respect to it. The budget amendment in total is about $10 million in revenue and $10 million in expenditures, which sounds humongous, but $8.8 million of it is the North Franklin Cambria Street VDOT grant. And then the HB3 Huckleberry Trail Phase 3 is another 800 and some odd thousand of it. So it sounds like a lot, but most of this is moving some capital project funds around, looking at some of the projects we're going to complete and some that we just need to do a little bit of reallocation with. So the bottom line to the general fund is an $8,192. I wish it was $8 million. Increase in fund balance with the net changes. But because it is so huge, we do have to anything over 1% of the originally approved budget has to have a budget hearing. So we will post that in the paper, and you approve the hearing for next meeting. It can be voted on at the next meeting after the public hearing. If there are interests or things that need to be changed, obviously we wouldn't have to approve it at that meeting. We could move it to the next meeting so the changes or whatever could be made. So you want me to run through all of the items, or if you feel comfortable with where we are with it, or questions?
Yeah, I have one question.
Okay.
Now, this doesn't look like what I'm looking at on my screen.
It does look a little different because I threw it into a PowerPoint.
No, when I looked at this, why in the world are we not using $400,000 in paving funds?
$200,000 in what?
Paving funds.
$400,000. As far behind as, you know, we... Anyway, it's a simple question. Why are
Mr.
we...
Mr. Stipes, the reason we're not is we have the West Main Street project that we're going to be doing. We have the Main Street project in follow-up to the improvement project. At this time in the fiscal year, it had not been designed. We began to sit down and select streets, and what we will end up doing is putting our paving project on a little different schedule. Our desire is to do our design so that we are positioned to bid during cold weather months and start work as soon as the warm weather comes.
So it's not actually, it's not a net decrease in paving, it's just a rescheduling of that outside.
We will combine into a larger project next year the work that would have been done on a smaller scale this year.
Good enough. We're not passing on any, okay, perfect, thanks.
We're not, yeah, right.
Thanks.
So most of the information is pretty much on page one. When I put these on here, it kind of shrinks them down and it doesn't have the same level of clarity. So the capital projects fund, you can see all the reallocations. So the VDOT North Franklin Cranberry Street project is 8.4 million in revenue, and the expenditure is almost 8.5. So that's really where the big changes come from. The net changes in this is a return of general fund support to the general fund of $46,124. Special revenue, this is mostly just recognizing some additional revenues, rolling over some projects that didn't get completed and delivered, and a little more funding for the downtown project that came in that we didn't know about at the time that we did the budget. And this is primarily the match funding will require a $91,000 increase in general fund support for special revenue. And a couple changes here. We had a little summation error right there. So there's an increase in the general fund, water and sewer fund of $27,000. So there's our net increases to fund balance and then storm drain. We're picking up an additional $200,000 in revenue. If you remember, the projections for the stormwater fee were like $1.3 million. Barry and I weren't real comfortable with first-year implementation as to total collectability of that $1.3 million. So we only put $1 million in the budget. We feel pretty comfortable at this point. 6 months in, we're at a pretty high collectability rate. I don't know if that'll continue to hold, but right now we're pretty comfortable with adding another $200,000 into the budget for stormwater revenues based on how they're tracking so far. So with the other changes in some of the projects, it'll create an $89,000 increase in the stormwater enterprise fund balance. So, and that's kind of all then summarized up on page one.
Mr. Quay, this doesn't require a, does this require us to take action to approve of this?
Not to this evening, no. Okay. We have to have a public hearing.
Right.
And that'll be next week, and then you will have to take action to approve the budget.
Due to the sheer size of the amendment?
Yes.
Understood.
Well, any budget amendment would require your approval, but the sheer size of it requires that there would be a
public hearing.
And that it be posted in the papers.
Okay.
We will go ahead and do that.
Any other questions? Thank you, Val. So, Terry, you're good, huh? You're just along for the ride. Okay, very good. Council reports, Mr. Collins, we've covered a lot of your stuff, I guess, haven't we?
Yes, sir. I'm fine, really.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Hall.
The last Recreation Commission meeting, the one item that was somewhat contentious, in regards, and you may hear some things about this, but I want to tell you. There's a quiet time period that's implemented at the Recreation Department in the mornings, and it basically lasts between 60 and 90 minutes. It's each day. It's kind of after the morning rush and before the lunchtime hour, and we've had some some comments solicited pro and con to maintaining that. That's been a staple, if you will, of the prior pre-lunch crowd. For quite some time, and so that's an item that we visited. We had some speakers on last time, and we're going to present some determination on whether or not to keep that at the April scheduled meeting. One other thing that came up, which is very interesting, CPR training was discussed for a time, if you will. A lot of the coaches and individuals that we have that are involved with youth athletics, Mr. Boyd, who was present earlier, his daughter actually is the one who gave me this little CD. The question they had was just make sure our coaches have CPR training. And we got to kind of throw this around, and I told the group I would reach out to the town manager and to through him through the EMS to see maybe if once a quarter we could have it kind of how we do the with the police department and with the citizens academies and all, and is to maybe have an opportunity maybe once a quarter to have an opportunity for a certain number of individuals in the town to get CPR certified. Be a good public outreach opportunity as well to show again additional ways in which we're investing in EMS and EMS is therefore investing in us. That's something we're looking at in the future. Tonight, in fact, my wife is at the Belmont Church doing CPR training from 6 to 9, if I recall, to get certified. And so, again, great community outreach opportunity. And the last thing I want to mention, and this is something that's been it's kind of languished quite some time, but it really kind of sparked an interest with the ball bank indicator, I believe is what it was called, for Mr. Nelson. We talked a lot in the last 3 or 4 years. We always heard about Allegheny and all, and about traffic calming measures, traffic calming matters, and ability to kind of look into that. And I think maybe the next meeting, or and maybe after we get into the budget cycle, we should look at that once more, just the traffic calming initiatives in the town. We had talked at one time about those speed humps, not speed bumps, and about the rubber eyes. I think we talked about that. They use those at the beach area and all. But I believe that that might be something we want to revisit, just to see what throughout town, if there's areas that have been identified, and maybe what we can do going forward. We just haven't heard much about it for about a year now, but it was kind of stoked when we heard about the ball bank indicator and how what a fantastic public safety technique that we now have access to, which I never even knew existed. Of course, I don't use apps anyway. But that's something I'd like for us in the future to look at. That's all I have to report, though, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Mr. Stumps?
No report.
Mr. Shaw?
I just have one. A few weeks ago, actually, yeah, a couple weeks ago, not last week. I'm not sure if all of us got, it was more or less a complaint about a resident who had their water cut off. And I reached out to Mr. Biggs, and, you know, I don't think this resident was really complaining about, you know, why. I think they understood why it was shut off and why there was a fee associated with it, but more or less communication. Of course, they gave some ideas about, you know, more of a manual reminder, go out, put a door hanger on the door, mount something out to them. Of course, we took this action to decrease cost and effort in that, but I would like to see if we could, for those customers that are on automatic payment, things of that nature, where we reduce receipts, if we could look into doing maybe a listserv for emails if they're late as a courtesy reminder. You know, of course, it's up whether we can implement or not, or whether we have the IT available to do it. I think it would be a great idea. And really, that was all that they were concerned with, is having some sort of notification. And I think, I know at Virginia Tech, and when I worked in finance years ago, we got, it's a courtesy email. You're late. It sort of tells them they're late. And we've just done that extra effort. Does it mean that we're not going to cut the water off eventually? In typical circumstances, no. But at least we've done our due diligence on that part. So can we look into that and just see if we can roll something out like that for the customers who have record of their emails?
We do have, working on an upgrade to the current software that will allow us to do that. And email all second notifications or class notices or whatever. Currently what we use is you have to have signed up for it.
Right.
Otherwise you don't get it. But the new build that we're looking at implementing for our software will allow us to click a box and it'll automatically send that out if there's a second notice that needs to go out.
Excellent.
So we'll roll that out as soon as we can get that done. IT's working on the build for us.
When it gets done, could you just give me a synopsis of it so I can respond to this, that we have done something to try to help them out?
Sure. But
I think what I heard you say, that they can already subscribe to that.
We have on our website, our regular Christiansburg website, under notifications, you can sign up for notification of late notice. It just tells you, you know, if you haven't paid by this date, you will be disconnected as of such and such a date. Mm-hmm. But you have to sign up for that. We don't just pull the email addresses off of the system. You have to have signed up for that notification to get that email.
So that's automated? So if the bill hasn't been paid, they'll get an automatic notice?
They're going to get
it. No, it goes, if they've signed up for that service, whether they've paid or not paid, they're going to get an email notice that says, today is blah, 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 your water bills are due by this date. If you haven't paid by this date, they will be disconnected on this date. So it's just a kind of a broad notification to anybody and everybody.
Could you send me the procedure for that?
Sure.
That'll open a can of worms that everybody's going to be calling, well, I paid my bill. Well, and I think you're going to, I think you'll create more of a monster with that than you will.
Well, that already exists. We just don't have a lot of people that have signed up for it.
All right.
So.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Tupper?
I just got three quick comments about the concern of the Aquatic Center. And I'm not sure if you know, but last week, I believe it was on Tuesday and Wednesday, they had the NCAA Diving Championship for males and females, and that went over well. And then this past weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, had over 1,100 kids from all around the state swimming at the Aquatic Center. And I passed a little flyer around. I'm not sure where it is right now, but this Friday, Relay for Life and the Aquatic Center are working together, and from 9 in the morning to 7 at night, and a person can go in there and swim for free in the two lanes in the leisure pool. And if you make a donation to Relay for Life, and we're thinking that this will be an opportunity for people who maybe don't normally go to the Aquatic Center to see what it's like, and also an opportunity that what they're going to do is have the two lanes open, and hopefully all the people that come during that period, that 10-hour period, will maybe accumulate 10 miles. And also they're hoping that we'll donate some money, and maybe the goal is $300. So if you are interested, or you know somebody wants to, just come on down there for a few minutes and go either walk, water walk, or swim in the leisure area, and should be a good deal. And it's going to be on St. Patrick's Day, and then you can go and drink some green beer afterwards.
Wow.
Yes.
Is that it?
Yes, sir.
I have a couple of brief things. I got a call from Chris Tuck. Ask if we would like to have him come to council for an update sometime in the next couple of months.
Always appreciate him doing
that. He's done that a couple of times. I told him it probably maybe the first meeting in April, and he seemed to think that was okay. So can I go ahead and are we doing a budget thing? Val, you looked up like, oh no, okay.
That'd be great.
April, I'll work with him and let you all know. Second thing is I think I put it in your package, or I emailed it out to you, this notice of Help Save the Next Throw Safety Summit.
Yep.
That is Saturday, the 18th, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
At the high school. Mark, are you familiar with that, or is that what your people are doing?
Yes, sir, we're involved in that.
And it's free, or is it not? I don't know. Okay, but it's really good. And y'all have done this thing a couple of times at the rec center, didn't you? And this part of the same?
The first one was done at the rec center, correct.
Okay. All right. I just wanted to make you all know, make you all aware of it. The second or third thing I have is April is Child Abuse Prevention Month. And somewhere along the line in your handouts, I gave you a copy of last year's, and I would like to bring that to a vote to renew the Child Abuse Prevention Week. I can do it. We can do it at our next meeting, or we can do it if I don't think there's anything says we can't do it tonight, and that way we'll have time to
go ahead and prove it tonight.
Yes, sir.
I would make a motion that we approve the Child Abuse Prevention Month proclamation as presented.
Second.
Motion is second. Mr. Hall, I'm sure the program is beginning to start taking place on this as far as the...
At the courthouse? We've already got two dates. April 27th is the one here.
Okay.
And the first Thursday in April, I'm thinking the 6th for some reason, I can't recall, is the one in Pulaski. They've got the lady who spoke actually on WSLS about 3 weeks ago coming there.
Very good.
Here we're hoping to have a young lady who was a former foster care, a former young lady who was benefited from the system, if you will, and is actually going to college now in the fall, in addition to we're looking at... we haven't determined who our speaker is going to be yet. There's I guess first choices, I think, not going to be available. But I'm going to continue to talk with the chief and some others about seeing what we want to go in the direction.
So I have a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion, comments?
I want to mention one thing about Help Save the Next Girl. I'm sorry. Yeah, you're talking about the proclamation. Absolutely. Okay. Sorry.
Thank you. Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye. You're right.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0. Thank you very much. Now, a question on the Help Save the Next Girl.
Just want to tell you, it's so refreshing. It's almost expected now. It's like the wrestling program winning another state championship. It's that our law enforcement, local law enforcement, is behind our young people. There's such a great marriage between the community and law enforcement, the county and the town. But the Help Save the Next Girl, I'm personally proud because my daughter's involved in it, of course, with Help Save the Next Girl. We're very passionate about it. But my understanding is on Friday, it's Hank Parton and three young people who have been here before, Cody, Savannah, and Kelsey, my daughter, are getting a chance to speak. I think it's to Fox News, if I recall, on Friday. They wanted to run it, yes. Okay. And it's going to be about the summit and about, I'm really not certain of the questions. I know Kelsey was a little nervous about it, about when she came home and we discussed it. But that's, again, yet another way in which the Christiansburg strand of the Help Save the Next Girl, which is huge, is really being recognized. And again, it's one half of the equation. It's because they have a great understanding and relationship with local law enforcement that really makes the car go, if you will. So, again, just kind of not so much a shout-out, but really an appreciative as a parent and, as frankly, as a member of the Christiansburg community, the Chief Sisson, and to Sheriff Parton.
Very good. I also have I think Madam Clerk sent me this request for a proclamation or a resolution. Is that right, Michelle?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And it is the Community Foundation River Valley. It's kind of a Give Big NRV Giving Day on April the 26th. And it's kind of recognizing all of the nonprofits and what they do.
Absolutely.
So, I would love to be able to proclaim that. Actually, I would do it in a resolution instead of a proclamation.
I want to say Mr. Warren is a member of the Community Foundation. Am I wrong?
I am.
They have we did some scholarship information and I sent I was of course the one that messed up the PDF in the doc, but they have a tremendous outreach and they have a tremendous board. Gary Hancock, of course, I really appreciate him from Pulaski. He's a mayor of Pulaski from before and an attorney. But Gary, Mr. Warren, there's a number of people who in our community that serve on that board. They give money back and certainly support our students, but fantastic board, in my opinion.
I'm sure you're putting that in the form of a motion.
I would make the motion that we absolutely execute a proclamation in regards to the Community Foundation.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, Madam Clerk.
I'm sorry. Are you a member of that board, Ms. Stiles?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Madam Clerk.
Ready? Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Howard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
So, thank you very much.
Mike, since we're talking about proclamations and resolutions, I'm sure we've got the wrestling team coming up or invited to council.
We're working on that. I talked to Melissa. We're kind of working on the date. There's a couple of things. And it may be within the scope of when that parade is starting, you know.
Could we include, a couple indoor track athletes or state champions?
Diver.
Yeah, we have a few sports to include, and that's kind of why we're waiting to get that full list. Yeah,
gotcha.
We're working on that.
We get Councilman Hall stop by the AD's office while he's in there.
The new AD at the high school, that's right.
Okay, so if that's it, Mr. Showalter?
Okay, I can just... I make a motion for a closed meeting under Virginia Code Section 2.2-3711A1 for the discussion, consideration, or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, performance, demotion, salaries, disciplining, or resignation of specific public officers, appointees, or employees of any public body. That's a form of a motion.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
That is 5-0. We're going to take, it is 5 minutes till. We will reconvene at 9.
I move to certify that the town council of the town of Christiansburg meeting in closed meeting in the best of each member's knowledge discuss only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law, and only such matters are as are identified in the resolution to enter into closed meeting. That's a motion.
Second.
Motion and second. No discussion. Madam Clerk.
Yes, sir. Councilman Collins.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Huppert.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
That is 5-0. There is no action to be taken, no decisions to be made at this point in time. And I'm trying to find my agenda. Anyway, is there anything else? Certification council action on the matter. Is there anything else to come before council?
Only that I'll make sure the next meeting, I will let you all know who the speaker is. I'll get with Chief on the Child Abuse Prevention Month, and that way we can move forward.
Okay. That sounds good to me. The other thing, I don't know whether you saw or not, it was on the website. There's a building codes seminar, Steve, Randy, the 23rd. Are y'all aware of that, the concept of that thing?
I'm not.
Okay. Well, we can shoot it to you.
Yes.
Well, tell us what we're doing.
We're doing some very good work through the inspections department, helping inform our builders and our owners and our designers of the advantages of using the adaptive building rehab code.
And we're having a meeting on that. Is that the one that's coming the 23rd?
That's right.
It's
okay.
Montgomery County.
It's on the page.
That's the time they talked about it being a new
year. Yeah, we sent out some information on a while back. I'll freshen it.
Thank you.
We've got 45 minutes left. You said you just pick a topic.
No, Burger King closes at 10:30, and I'm hungry.